Happy day. Good morning.
Mike, I made you co-host. That way you can share your screen or do whatever you need to do, okay?
That would be awesome. Are you going to be letting people in?
I can sit here and let people in.
If you can just do that, that'd be awesome, so I don't have to look and watch.
I will do it.
That's awesome. Also, can you pin me to the top? Are you able to do that from your end?
I honestly don't know that work. I went ahead and pinned you.
Okay, that's cool.
Okay.
That works.
You don't have to be afraid, son. You can do what any man done. If you want to try, move the man. To brave but the man who will crush into the web. That's a life that you find. Just go around the corner of a rinse pain.
Good morning, everyone.
Hey, Mike, how you doing?
Awesome. How's everybody?
Doing great.
Thank you, Mike.
Mike, I got you pinned up, buddy. So you're on the screen. I can see your PowerPoint. So I think we're good.
I appreciate you.
No, I appreciate you teaching. This is going to be exciting. It's going to be a good one.
Yep. Somebody keeps moving the slides.
Is that your screen that we're looking at or somebody else sharing?
No, this is my screen.
Okay. Just wanted to make sure it wasn't me touching stuff and messing you up. I'm going to go into our conference room and check us. I'll be right back.
Yeah, we'll give it another couple of minutes.
All right, we're ready. We're set up and ready to go in Elite. Looks like Heartland's on and Excel's on. So we'll have a couple people jumping in, I'm sure, as independent. But Mike, you're a full go ahead when you're ready, buddy.
All right, let's get started here. Let me get back up here. All right. Good morning, everyone, and welcome to Ignite. This is super exciting for me, and it's super exciting for Kelly to be a part of this incredibly important experience for everyone. And Matt asked me to sub in this week. And fortunately, this is one that's right in my wheelhouse. So I feel like we can add a lot of value for you today. And I feel like we can provide a lot of information that will be usable, and just expect a couple of things from me. I will go off script because that's who I am. And I will also be trying to provide you with some real tools that you can use. So a little bit about me. Well, first, I always like to start anytime we're doing a training with the Keller Williams mission, which you all know, is careers worth having, businesses worth owning, lives worth living, experiences worth giving, and legacies worth leaving. That is something that we remind ourselves, Kelly and I, pretty much every day. And it's a great way to center and start the day. So I always like to start with that. My name is Mike Davis. I'm the director of operations for the Kelly Wiley Group. We're out of Excel, and Kelly has a mega agent office down in Jackson, Ohio, and another in Chillicothe, Ohio. And Kelly is a 16-year veteran, and I got tagged in to be involved after she came to Keller Williams in 2020 to act as director of operations. And my role really is to run the sales team and keep the back of house parts and pieces and machinery moving, if you will. So that is what I do. And sales management is near and dear to me. It's something that I've done almost all of my career. And it's something that I feel like I'm pretty okay at. So just to give you a little bit of background, the Kelly Wiley Group joined in May of 2020. Kelly had been an independent broker for a lot of years. She was very successful, and she was tired of doing a lot of the things that independent brokers have to do, and was looking for a number of things, but probably the most prominent was a group of like-minded people to work with and work off of and to share with and to learn from. And so it has been a phenomenal experience. In 2019, the group did about $10.5 million in business. And in 2020, up that to about $16 million in volume. And then in 2021, we were able to increase that to $38 million in volume. And we did $1.15 million in gross commission income, which is the first phase of being a millionaire real estate agent. And I can't tell you how proud we are of that. It's something that was a big goal. And in October of 2020, at a planning summit, I vividly remember writing that number on a piece of paper because Kellyanne told me I had to, just point blank. She said, "You guys can do this." And I didn't have any idea how we were going to do it. And none of us did. But we said, okay, if you believe in us, we're going to believe in the system. And we did it. And we're incredibly proud of it and excited about that accomplishment. In the Market Center, we won a bunch of awards last year, number one group in a lot of categories. So that was very, very exciting. And I don't tell you this stuff to brag or be obnoxious. I'm telling it to you for a very specific reason. And that reason is it was done by simply following the model. There's no magic to it. It's just about following the model. You know, the Red Book has all of the answers in it for the most part, and you just have to be willing to listen to it and trust it. So following there's five pieces of it that really are what allowed us to propel into that next level. Following the model was one. Kelly embraced coaching, went to high level MAPS coaching for leadership. That made a huge difference. I got involved in coaching. We got our sales team MAPS coach, and it has made an enormous difference. We systematize everything, which is super important for today's session, because so much of what we're going to talk about today is about systematizing your processes. And if you will do that, you will make your life so much easier. The other thing that we do is leverage every single thing that we possibly can. We leverage it through technology, and we leverage it through people, either by boots on the ground locally or cyberbackers. Kelly and I, as a side note, also own the cyberbacker franchise for Northern Ohio. So we're pretty into the cyberbacker thing, as you might imagine. And the fifth piece of that puzzle is we focus on the 20%. I don't know that there's ever been a business where it's more evident that if you focus on your 20%, your results will be exponential. So that's kind of a little backstory on us and what we do. So today, and I'm going to have to keep this thing moving. So today we are going to get into lead follow-up, which is the third segment of Ignite. So far you've covered becoming the real estate expert of choice in your area. And hang on, I'm letting people in as we go. Building your value proposition, which is incredibly important. And also you've covered lead gen if you've been through all of the modules through advertising and marketing. Lead gen is the easy part. I'll just be blunt about it. Getting leads is easy. What to do with them after you get them. The script says can make or break your business. I'm going to tell you it will make or break your business. No ifs, ands, or buts about it. It is a handling your lead gen properly is the thing that will propel you forward. And you'll do that by systematizing and a number of, and using the tools that you have laid out in front of you. And you have to understand that it is a process. It takes time and, more than anything, patience. You have to be willing to put in that time and put in that patience in order to make it work. Also, if I could, if you guys wouldn't care, hang on, I gotta go back here. Could everybody go off of, I'd love to see everybody's faces, and I will call on you from time to time. If you can turn your cameras on, it really would be very, very helpful. I wanna know you're out there. It really will make a big difference for everybody in the room. And I appreciate that. So the next segment that we're going to talk about, and I'm going to make sure where we're at. Here we go. So you've gone from becoming a real estate expert to lead generation, and now we're going to talk about follow-up, and we're going to talk about how you make that piece work for you. And what you're going to do is turn a possible business into a probable business. And then you're going to take that probable business and you are going to turn it into a profitable business by doing this. And you have to do it every single day. One of the things that we find you fight a lot is this wave of business that a lot of agents seem to get caught in, and they can't find a way to get out of. And the way that you get out of it is by consistently lead genning and then handling your backside of the lead gen, which is the lead follow-up process. So today we're really going to focus on the lead follow-up process. We're going to talk about the daily success system, how that works, what you need to be doing. Before we get started in any of that, though, can anybody tell me the four laws of lead generation? Just unmute and spit them out if you know them. Somebody, please. It's on page 188 of the MREA. I can tell you that. There's a hint for you. The four laws of lead gen are, and this goes way, way back. Gary Keller figured this out many, many years ago. You got to build a database. You got to feed the database every day. You have to communicate with your database, and you need to do it in a very systematic manner. And then you need to follow up when those people raise their hand. And that last number four is the one that so many people don't seem to be able to grasp. You have to follow up. You have to be quick about your follow-up, because there are a lot of people that they could call, and you're really working hard to position yourself as the one person. And when they raise their hand, you got to get on it. So bear in mind that a lot of what we're going to talk about today has everything to do with those four laws of lead generation, because they matter so much. We are going to talk today about keeping every lead, following up with leads, strengthening relationships, qualifying potential buyers and sellers. All of that will go through. Kelly will cover part of it in the second half of the day. From 1 to 3, you guys are going to have a treat. She typically doesn't teach these things. She has a staggering amount of experience and success under her belt. And it's not that she doesn't want to teach. It's that she's so busy doing what she does that it doesn't allow her a lot of time to be able to do those things. And so today is going to be kind of a special treat for everybody, because she is awesome at it. So the lead follow-up process is essential to converting leads to business from the moment you've captured a lead and put it in your database. So let's talk about a database for a second. There's a lot of different ways that you can database your leads, and you can keep them in your head. Some people put them on index cards. Some people keep their database in their phones, and other people keep them in a CRM. Because you made the very wise decision to come to Keller Williams, you have access to some of the most groundbreaking technology in the industry. You have at your disposal Command. You have an incredible CRM platform that will do amazing things for you. And we'll get into a lot of them today and how to systematize those. But you need to make sure that you are absolutely using Command every day, that your database is in there, that you're nurturing your database, that you're feeding it, that you're adding to it, that you're taking all of those leads and you're adding as much information as you possibly can to those leads, because every bit of information that you have makes your job easier when you're following up. So we'll be getting into a lot of that today. Hang on here. Okay, so one of the things that I'd like to get into first is when it comes to Command, when it comes to all of the things that we're going to talk about, it's about the process. It's about making progress every single day. It's about doing something to move you forward every day. And I want you to keep in mind, and we talk about this a lot on our team, and we talk about it a lot with our marketing department. We talk about it a lot with our social media department as well. Done is always better than perfect. Do not get caught in the paralysis by analysis trap, if you will, and make sure that you are doing things to move yourself forward every single day. Encourage each other, celebrate your successes. That all matters. And one of the things that I know that they've been talking to you about in previous sessions is having an accountability partner. Can everybody just kind of raise your hand if you would, and let me know, do you have an accountability partner? Do you have somebody that you're working with that is helping, that you're helping each other, that you're doing role plays, that you're doing scripting, that you're doing all of those things? Because you really, really, truly need to have an accountability partner. It matters. It's one of those things that you will make and break your career, period, point blank. The criteria that you want to look at for having an accountability partner, you need to have somebody who is also success-driven, somebody that's committed to the process, and somebody that is willing to feel uncomfortable until they get it right. Sitting and looking at each other and doing script practice is not a natural thing. And it takes practice to get that script practice right. It's it's not natural and it can be very uncomfortable. And when you're going through the various scripts and you're talking about overcoming objections and those things, you're going to fumble over your words and you're going to struggle with all of that. And that's okay. That's part of the process. And the more you do it, the better that you'll get at it. But that accountability partner, having that person that's on the phone or on the Zoom or in your office every single day that's committed along with you, that will make you better. And it will make it so when it's time for you to get on the phone and talk to somebody, those objections that you're hearing, you have the answers for them and you don't have to think about it and you don't have to stumble. So find yourself an accountability partner and be willing to engage in that process. I had a lesson some years ago. So what a lot of, some of you may know, some of you don't know, I, by training and education, I'm a professional brewer of beer. And when I was just getting started, I was doing a visit in a pretty good sized brewery, and I was talking to the brewmaster, and he just continued to bang the drum on the concept that the only way to learn to make great beer is to make crappy beer until you get it right. You just have to keep doing it over and over and over again. And that accountability piece is the exact same concept. You have to just keep doing the script work. You have to keep going over your numbers. You have to keep talking about your plans and how you're implementing them. And you have to do all of these things every single day. And if you're smart and if you're really committed to the career, you'll plan on doing it every day for the rest of your career. And you'll go from being the person who is being helped to the person who's making a difference in someone else's life. Now, you'll still learn, you'll still get better, but your role will change in it. And it's just, and you'll lead by example. And it's a super important thing. So I want everybody to really, really focus on that. If you do not have an accountability partner, go find one and make sure that they are committed to the same things that you are. Today, we're going to cover what is lead follow-up, how to follow up a lead. We're going to talk about post-lead follow-up. We're going to recap. We're going to do some ahas. And then we're going to talk about the daily success system that you can implement to make sure that your career takes off and you can get to where you want to be as fast as you can be. This model, I used to sit back and marvel. I like McDonald's franchises where, you know, somebody walks in the door and they put them on the French fry line and they hand them a manual on how to make French fries. Like, that's crazy to me. And it starts with, this is a French fry and this is where the French fries are. And this is a bag of French fries. And this is what you do next and next and next. The Keller Williams model is the exact same thing. It's the best in the industry. I know realtors from a lot of different flags besides Keller Williams that have built their careers on the Red Book, on Gary Keller's Millionaire Real Estate Agent. I talked to one that Matt and I were talking to trying to recruit not too long ago, and the guy told me he'd read the book 8 times. Kelly reads it every single day. Every day, she reads a chapter, she reads something in it, because you go back to it and that's part of her daily success system. So, you know, these are things that you're gonna want to take with you and do. By the end of today, you're going to be able to describe the benefits of establishing a system of lead follow-up. You're going to be able to apply the 19 to Connect Touch campaign with leads, which flat will work. It is one of the models that absolutely will work. If you work the model will work for you. You're going to be able to explain the importance of cementing the relationships with your leads. So those are the things that we're going to focus on. So to start thinking about what you're going to learn today, let's consider what questions you might have about lead follow-up. And what I'd like for everybody to do is just take a minute and write down a question or some questions or whatever. Please, at least one question that you feel might be relevant to today's topic. Just take a minute, 30 seconds, whatever. And I'll go back to you. Again, I'm going to ask everybody to please turn your cameras on so I can see you. That would be very, very helpful. Okay, hopefully by now you've got a question. So someone give me a question, just unmute your mic and give me a question that you would be interested in today. We need to get a little participation going here. Anybody? Emily, Thomas, give me something.
I literally just don't think of a question. I'm still thinking of one.
Okay, all right. Let's go to James Herzog, give me a question. Give me something today that you'd like to get from this. All right. Tough crowd, man. All right. All right, going to the next slide. If everybody could turn to the lead follow-up page and your participant guide, I believe that it's page 11. Let's talk about what a lead is and then what a contact is. Now, you guys have already learned this. Can anybody give me the answer on that one? You guys are killing me. Come on.
A one-way conversation and contact are two-way combos.
Boom. Yes. Thank you so much. All right. I apologize in advance. I get a little excited. Yeah, that's absolutely correct. And thank you for that response. And so a lead is someone who is interested in what you do. That's the simplest way to put it. And a contact is someone with whom you have had a meaningful two-way conversation. And the reason why that is super important is that differentiation between just having someone who's interested in what you do and someone with whom you've had a meaningful two-way conversation is it's implied that they're going to at least listen to you and they're open to hearing more from you if you've had a two-way conversation. So it's really, really important that we understand that and understand that the process is two different things, right? The process of getting them to engage with you and have a two-way conversation is different from nurturing them and having that nurture create an environment where over time you can become the top of mind person for them. Every person in your database, whether they're a lead or a contact, requires follow up so that when they have a need, they will immediately think of you. One of the things that I want you to be super clear on is that the people you've got in your database, you're not the only database that they're in, right? They're in multiple people's databases. They know people who are agents. They've come into contact with people who are agents who are effectively working their database, who are doing all of the right things. And if you're not, you lose to those people. So it's critically important that you understand that. You have to work your database. And that's how you ensure that they think of you when it comes time to be the person to take care of their real estate needs. All right, next, we're gonna look at a quick graphic. And this would be the life of a lead. And most people move 7 to 10 times throughout their lifetime, some more. If you are fortunate enough to get involved with real estate investors who buy rental properties or short-term rentals or things like that, then you have a lot more opportunity with those folks because it's more transactional. It's more driven by opportunity than it is by a cycle of moving or moving up or moving down, as it were, depending on where they are at in their life cycle. But a lot of people get confused about when is the best time to contact these people based on these cycles. You know, you're talking about 7 to 10 years in between them on average. So if I give you a lead that is nearing, if they're going up the slope, if you will, and they're getting near the top and you see this, okay, that's a pretty good lead. But does that make someone who just purchased a home, who's going down the other side, does that make them a bad lead? Absolutely not. And the reason is super simple. You are always able to leverage the leads in your database, if not for them, but for the other people that they know. People do business with people they know, like, and trust. Doesn't matter whether you're selling eggs or real estate or whatever else, cars, it doesn't matter. They do business with people they know, like, and trust. So if you have someone who refers you, meaning if you have a past client or you have someone in your sphere that refers someone to you, then you benefit from the fact that the person who did the referring is known, liked, and trusted by the person they referred. That flows over onto you. If they trust you, then you must be okay. So we constantly work our databases, because it's not just about buying or selling for the people in the database. It's leveraging those people to get to their friends, neighbors, relatives, coworkers, whoever else they know, the people at the school, whoever it is. We need that in order to keep our careers moving forward. It's critically important. So every single day, you don't differentiate between where they're at in the timeline. The quality of lead is irrelevant. Those leads will refer to you, and they will make or break your career very often. So let's talk about this a little bit. Moving from a possible business. When you start in the industry, you have a possible business. By the way, Keller Williams is one of the only companies that you'll ever see that doesn't just teach you how to sell real estate, that doesn't just teach you how to properly complete a transaction. Their goal is to teach you to run a business. So when you get into the MREA and you look at the various levels of a business, pay attention to that, because it works. We've seen it. It absolutely works. So you start with a possible business, and by creating a database and doing all of the right things and lead genning and loading up your database, you now can move that possible business to a probable business. And then if you continue to execute properly and you feed those leads and you stay in contact with them and you do a 19-1 leads to contacts program, and then you do a 36 touch program on your contacts, you will move your business from probable business to profitable business. I promise you will. It works. The model works. The only question will become, are you willing to work? Are you willing to do the things? And to that point, and I'm going to stop for a second and cover this. When you're talking about the models, don't get confused. And it's a lot of times we see agents want to do the part of the model that they feel comfortable with, or do the part of the model that they like to do, and forget about the rest of the model. It won't work. Like, it might work a little bit, but it will not work at the level that you want it to work. The simple truth of the matter is, you're in an industry where you can make hundreds of thousands of dollars, hundreds of thousands of dollars. If you're at the top levels, you can make millions of dollars, and there's a lot that do. But in order to do that, it's not easy. There's nothing easy about it. You can't hit the easy button. It won't work. You have to do the things that you have to do every day. You have to be willing to be uncomfortable, and you have to be willing to put in the effort. And over time, and it's not an instantaneous effort. Kelly always talks about what you're getting today is the net result of what you did somewhere between 3 months ago and 6 months ago. All of that effort that you put in, all of that lead gen, And I used to be a little skeptical about it. And having been involved with her sales cycle now for a while, I can tell you it absolutely is true. Every single time without fail. If you take time off, if you decide that you're going to take the summer off because you had a pretty good spring, you are going to have a wickedly bad winter and you're going to be scrambling and panicking. And you're going to have this thing, the ups and downs. You don't want that. You have to do it on a daily basis. And you have to be the person that makes themselves do it. You should want to earn hundreds of thousands of dollars. You should want to earn millions of dollars if you can, because it's available to you. If anything worth doing is worth getting paid a lot, you know, it's just that simple. So an interesting statistic. In 2021, the NAR, the National Association of Realtors, did a profile on home buyers, and they were able, through their data collection means, which is some of the best in the industry, to determine that 73% of buyers only talked to one agent. 82% of sellers only talked to one agent. And that's even when it doesn't make sense. And I'll give you a classic example of this. And it happened to us this week. We had a client call in and wanted to talk about listing their home. And you have to understand that so there's a big difference between our group and the person that ended up getting the listing. The person that ended up getting the listing is a part-time realtor who has no infrastructure, no advertising, no discernible sphere of influence, but it was somebody that they knew. While we've got this marketing juggernaut machine with professional photography and professional drone work and success story after success story and an enormous following on social media, all of that, right? And they chose the other person. It was the first person that they talked to. So they just went with them. And it happens all the time. And so what we're talking about today is ensuring that you are the person when it comes time for them to make a decision on a transaction, whether they're going to buy or whether they're going to sell, or even whether they're going to refer someone to you, they think of you. You are the top of mind person that they immediately associate with real estate. Because if not, you are not just liable to, you're likely to lose in a lot of those situations. And you don't think it's important until, and this is the one that hurts the most, when somebody in your family works with somebody else. And don't think it doesn't happen, because it happens every single day. Someone in your family will work with someone else and you'll be infuriated and you won't understand why. And the reason why, if you step back and look at it, is because that person spent more time, made more touches, stayed in contact, put themselves in the right place at the right time, whatever it was, make no mistake, it will happen. And when that one happens, it'll hurt. So I'm going to tell you how important it is. I'm going to give you a couple of examples. I'm going to tell you just briefly about our two. We have two buyer agents, Chris O'Boyle and Kendra Gamble. And last year they did enormous numbers, because they followed the models. They do everything that we asked. So Chris O'Boyle came to us. He was a lieutenant in the Ohio prison system. And the beginning of COVID, the very, very beginning of COVID, he was tasked with, Chris, he's an MBA guy, super smart. And he was tasked with writing all the protocols for how they were going to handle COVID in the prisons and all of this stuff. And the pressure became so intense that one day, he thought he was having a heart attack in the prison on duty. And the only thing that he could think about was them getting him out of the gates because he did not want to die of a heart attack in that place. And they got him to the hospital, rushed him to the hospital and all of that. And what they determined was that it was stress induced. So he made the decision that he was going to throw away, not throw away, he was going to put away a 20-year career. And he was going to do something completely different. And he was going to trust us to help him get into the real estate business. And so Chris is very well known in our area. He's involved in a lot of causes. He's out there all the time. I mean, he's really an out there kind of guy. And it became very apparent to me that Chris, his identity was lieutenant in the prison system. And the only way he was going to be successful was if we could change the way people thought about him. So I didn't make his number when we did his goals when he started, we did a 135 and it had nothing to do with numbers or units or anything else. The goal for Chris was to change people's perception of him, of change the view of him from lieutenant in the prison system to real estate professional. And that was what he worked on. And he did it through working his contacts and through talking about real estate and through learning and becoming super intelligent in the business of real estate. He really worked hard at it. And I've got Kendra Gamble, who was a single mom, like single mom, totally on her own, doing her own thing, was a server at a restaurant. And came to Kelly, and Kelly saw something in her and put her through the process, and we got her licensed, and she took off, and she trusted that she would be able to help her clients, and she did. And over time, it was real funny to watch. Because at that time we were getting Zillow, we were buying Zillow, we were the number one Zillow team in the entire area, and we were just leads out the yin yang from Zillow, and she was killing those. But her sphere, the people that she knew, her friends, neighbors, relatives, those people, they weren't using her. And so she worked incredibly hard at making herself be that agent of choice among her sphere and to get them their business, to get their referrals. And both of them did one simple thing every single day that I think made as much difference as anything else. Every person that they encountered, every person that they talked to, they simply asked them one question. You can preface this however you want. It's the most easy, non-offensive question that you'll ever hear when it comes to real estate. It's the softest closed question that you'll ever hear. Depending on how they knew them, you can start with either, hey, I don't know if you know or not, but I've recently changed careers. I'm in real estate now. It's something that I have a huge passion for. I love it. And I just wondered, do you have any plans to buy or sell this year? That's it. Everybody that they encountered. Now the answer to that's yes or no, right? Super non-offensive. And then if they say yes, great, you deal with it. If they say no, great. You simply ask, do you know anyone else? Do you have any friends, neighbors, or relatives that might be buying or selling this year? That's it. And because they constantly went out and asked people that question over and over and over again, that perception of them changed. So now they're adding these people to their database. They're growing their database. They're still continuing to get leads from other sources, and they're continuing to work and nurture their database. And over time now, what we're seeing is that last year, I believe, and if I'm wrong, I apologize, but I'm about 99% sure I'm right. Chris O'Boyle was the number one agent in Excel in terms of units sold in the entire market center. I'm pretty sure that that's the case. And Kendra Gamble was right behind him. And they're no longer just getting leads from other places. Well, we cut off Zillow a year ago, but it's because that now their sphere, their people, when they think of real estate, they think of Chris Gamble or Chris O'Boyle and Kendra Gamble. And it's because they have continually done the right things. They've made the phone calls. They've made the touches. They've sent out the information. They've done all of the right things. They've nurtured their database. And it's paying off huge dividends. And now they're getting, instead of just getting, hey, I'm interested in buying a house calls, now they're getting come list me calls. Not, hey, I'm going to talk to two or three agents and I want you to come and I'd like to talk to you. They're getting come to my house. I want you to list it calls, which is incredible. And their businesses continue to grow because every day they do the right things and they continue to do all of the things that we're talking about today. And again, I'm going to say the question again. In the next year or so, do you have any interest or do you have any plans to buy or sell a home? No? Great. Do you know anyone who's talked about buying or selling a home? That's it. It'll change your life. I promise it will. All right. If you aren't first or second in the client's mind, you probably won't get the business. That's a Gary Kellerism. It's absolutely correct. We know it to be correct. The NAR statistics back it up, and that's probably not a thing that's ever going to change. Yes, you do have people who are savvy buyers or who are probably entrepreneurs, business people, executives who don't really have a great contact, who might get a hold of two or three agents and ask them to come out and essentially interview for the job. And you better be able to do that too. But isn't it a lot easier if they just call you and say, hey, you're the first person I thought of. Can you please come and sell me a house, sell my house, whatever it might be. And this is a concept of taking up space in people's minds through staying in close emotional proximity to them. It's called mind share. Emotional proximity is a result of engaging in the touches with your database. And I'm going to add to that by saying it's not just touches, it's quality touches, it's meaningful touches. And we'll get into some of that. So when you think back to the day you learned about lead generation, what touches are the strongest? Somebody unmute and tell me what touches are the strongest. Anybody? Come on. All right. Face-to-face touches are going to be your strongest. Telephone touches are going to be your second strongest. If you can get in front of somebody, that's always best. You're going to have the most meaningful contact or meaningful engagement with someone if you're in front of them. On the phone is a very, very close second. And then you get into the emails, text, social media, all of this other stuff. And I want to make sure that you understand that if you really want to have your database be your most valuable asset, it will require you to be uncomfortable. If calling someone to talk about real estate is not something that you're super comfortable with, then you need to get over it. You need to figure out a way to get through it. You need to be able to figure out a way to reprogram the way you see it, whatever you have to do. Because getting in front of people and talking to them on the phone are absolutely 100% essential to you being successful at a high level in this business. That's not ever going to change. That's how you form bonds. That's how you form relationships with people. I think that it's a lot of it is just getting straight in your head what you're doing when it comes to the whole process and being strategic. And so I had an agent that I couldn't fix a year or so ago that just couldn't get it straight in their head. And it was maddening for me to see, because the last thing we want to do, we're not trying to sell people something that they don't want. You know, we're not trying to shove houses in people's ears. That's not what we do. And if you're doing that, it's a waste of time, because it doesn't work ever under any circumstance. What we're trying to do is stay in touch with people. And then when it's time for them to have a need or know someone who has a need, raise their hand. That's what we're going for here. We're not trying to sell people things they don't want. That hardcore sales approach doesn't work. And we need to make sure that we're not trying to engage in that, because it's very off-putting for people. And it's the exact opposite of how you want them to see you. What we want to do through our efforts at working our CRMs and engaging is we want to create value for people. We want to provide them with information that they think is important. And it is like, that's the only thing that we're trying to do is engage and have them see us as the person who will take care of their needs, because it's obvious that we're knowledgeable. It's obvious that we're committed. It's obvious that we are successful for other people. Therefore, the assumption is we will be successful for them. All of that, that's what we're going through through these touches. And so make sure that you're straight in your head. We're not trying to sell people something that they don't want. Get over it, get through it, or get past it, this idea of not wanting to call people. And one of the ways that you can do that, I have found the easiest way to do it, and I've done it in multiple industries, is make darn sure that when you are doing your calls, your touch calls, you have a very definite reason for calling, and that reason has value for the people that you're calling, that you're providing some piece of information or some engagement that they will find valuable. That could be as simple as it might be you're calling them because it's their birthday. You're calling them because you saw their kid Bobby on Facebook had a birthday or first soccer goal, whatever it might be. And then at the end of that engagement, your question is, do you know anybody who's interested in buying or selling right now? Are you thinking about buying or selling in the next year? Great, I would love to work with you, right? But you've given them, you can give them something about the market in their area. You can give them something about an event that's coming up in your town. Hey, I just want to give you a call. Did you know the Apple Festival is the third week of September? And you're not going to believe this, but they have ABC Banana Band is going to be there. Yeah, I know they've got a hit song on the radio right now. I just wanted to make sure you knew that. Awesome. Are you guys thinking about buying or selling in the next year? Do you know anyone who's interested in buying or selling in the next year? Give them something of value. And now all of a sudden it's not a cold call. It's not a sales call. I'm just connecting with you to give you something that I think you might need call. I had a bold coach tell me one day that one of the best lines that he had ever used, and he said he blurted it out one day, didn't know where it came from. He assumes he heard it from someone and just can't remember who, is that, hey, when I make these calls, I don't want to discriminate against anybody. I want all my friends and all the people that I know to have this information. So if it's not of super value to you, I apologize, but I just want everybody to, I don't want anybody to think I'm not giving them the information. And he said it works like a charm. So it's not one that I've used, but he loves it. So, but by doing this, you continue to put yourself in front of that person, and they see you over time, and they see you more, and they see you more, and they see you more as the person of value, the person who knows the real estate game, who is successful, who provides value for their client. And that's what we want for you. Once we get into lead follow-up, it's so habitual. You have to take the time to do it. And we're going to get into the daily success thing in a little while. But taking the time and making it a part of your day will pay so many dividends. There are no words to describe how important it is. It's something you have to do. And you have to do it in a way that you're comfortable, and over time you'll get more comfortable. Remember, if at first you're not great at it, don't quit, keep doing it. The best way to learn to make beer is to make crappy beer until you learn to make good beer. Same principle over and over again. So we want to follow up by providing value. That's how we follow up with leads. And that also applies to other things as well. It applies to our social media posts. It applies to our direct mail contact. It applies to our text messaging campaigns. It applies to postcards, whatever it might be. If we're adding value to that person, they're more likely to look at it, engage with it, whatever the case might be, and have that piece of information affect them in a way that works to your benefit. So, all right. The fortune is in the follow-up, mindshare. So these are the recommended systems for whatever you want to call it. They call it touch campaigns. I call it drip campaigns. However it was introduced to you in the lead gen segment, with leads, we're going to focus more on the 19 touch to connect campaign. That one is the one that we're going to use. And let's say you have someone that calls in and they're interested in a house. They call in on your website, they're interested in a house. It's a lead that you get from realtor.com, from Zillow, from whatever. Your goal is to have a meaningful two-way conversation about real estate. And you have to determine what that is for yourself before you switch them. But you really, really need to have that super high value touch with them. And the average is, it takes 19 touches to be able to connect with them at that level. Because when you're talking to somebody at that level, it's almost as though they're already trusting you enough to at least have a conversation with you. You've gone from just being this abstract person that's out there who they had some connection with somewhere that ended up with their name and their phone number and their email address and their address. And you switch from being that to being someone they're at least going to trust enough to have a meaningful two-way conversation with. Because you have to have that in order to get them to the next level. So remember, it's a two-part process here. We're not trying to take them from a lead to a closed sale right from the rip. That happens, sure. You get the lead from somebody calls in on your website or they call into the office because they saw an advertisement for a house, and you take them to the house and they buy the house. It happens. Yes, absolutely it does. And when it does, it's a bonus. It's an awesome bonus, right? But I'm going to tell you, it's not the norm. The norm is you get the lead and you have to work it to get them to trust you enough to talk to you. And then you have that conversation, and then you move them to contact status. Now they're not a lead, they're a contact. And at that point, you're going to treat them differently. So the 19 to connect, you're talking about 4 touches, a quarterly phone call once a quarter, 12 touches once a month. They're getting something from you of value, a monthly email, a newsletter, a market report, a video, something that they're getting. 2 touches, you want to be a promotional, some type of promotional direct magnet, a calendar, a printed market report, whatever it might be. Look, doing a market report is super easy. And I could tell you, if you're going to do one of these, in my experience, and other people may disagree with me, and that's perfectly fine, it may work great for them. Using things like magnets and things like that simply cost money and don't do very much for you. You don't get a lot of value from that. calendars are the same things. A lot of people do it. They swear by it, and that's great. We just haven't seen it on our end. And then One Touch, like have some type of annual event, a party, a movie screening, a get-together, something. A great one, you can rent out a movie theater on a Tuesday night or a Wednesday night or a Monday night or even a Sunday night a lot of times. Rent out a movie theater, send your database or send your high-value people in your database invites to come to a free movie. And you can rent a lot of movies for not a lot of money. They're out there. You just talk to the movie theater. And this is a big one that people do. And what you're doing is creating value that they get to take their kid to the movie. You're paying for it. You stand up before the movie starts and you thank everyone for coming. And you let them know that if they have any interest or need to sell or buy a property in the next 12 months, let you know. Or if they know anyone who's interested in buying or selling, just let you know. You appreciate them coming. Thank you very much. And I'm telling you, you can do that for a pretty low cost and get a good turnout and get in front of a lot of people. So it's a super, like those things really, really work. So if you follow this program, but what I will tell you is you have to do the planning. You have to do the work. You can't throw together a newsletter in 10 minutes and you can't make a decision. You need to do a marketing plan at the beginning of the year that you're going to do your four quarterly touches and what your 12 touches are going to be, whether they're an email, whether they're going to be a newsletter, some type of market report or whatever. Market reports are easy. You can get the data to do a market report. There are sample market reports everywhere. You can get the data super easy. You can get access to an HTML processing program where you can make a really cool email that's not just words, but words, graphics, all of that, and send it through MailChimp. It costs very, very little. So like those things are not hard, but you have to plan them in advance. You have to execute them. The devil is always in the details on these things, and you can't half-ass them. You must do them correctly in order for them to work, because people inherently understand a couple of things. One is whether or not you're really trying, and two is when you're trying to get in their pocket. That's why if you invite them to a movie, don't stand there and tell them that you are the greatest thing since sliced bread and you've closed houses, because they're just going to vomit. They don't care. You're there to provide them a value. You're there to give them an experience with their family. And that's what they're going to remember you for. And there's nothing wrong with saying, hey, if you guys have a need by yourself, please let me know. You know, friends, neighbors, relatives, so that's fine. But it's a soft sell. You don't have to beat them over the head with it, because it will work, be counter to what you want. So you want to make sure that you're doing your 19 touch plan correctly. If you need help with this stuff, talk to people in your market center. If you don't have a coach, if you can't afford a coach, then there are a lot of resources out there for you who will give you coaching. Find a mentor in your market center. Find someone who's really good, who you admire, and ask them if you can pick their brain, if you can buy them lunch, if you can buy them a drink, whatever. But get that information. The Keller Williams culture is so giving and so sharing, and everyone wants everyone to do well, because we live by a belief in abundance, you know, not scarcity. And so finding someone who will help you with these things, who will tell you what's worked for them, it's easy to do. And if you don't do it, it's because you're not committed to the process. So please make sure you are 100% engaged in this. Off to our next. Oh, I'm gonna go back to that for a second, because I made a note here and I didn't go over it. So when somebody raises their hand, this is super important. You've done all of this work. You've done your 19 to connect. You've made your phone calls. You've done your touches. You've done all of this. And then when somebody raises their hand, they call you, they contact you direct on social media. that what, however they reach out to you, they call your office for you, whatever, it's a direct call. Someone's contacting you directly. They're raising their hand. They're saying, I am interested when they do that. Speed to that lead is everything. You've got to get back with them incredibly fast. Some of you may or may not heard of an agent by the name of Ben Kenny. Ben is an enormous expansion agent. He makes millions of dollars a year, closed somewhere around 3,000 sides this last year, his team. He's in a bunch of states, he's in a bunch of cities. And I listen to what he says because he didn't get to where he is for no reason. And one of the things that he talks about a lot is his mindset when it comes to having someone raise their hand. You work so hard to get someone to raise their hand. And so if he's at dinner and someone calls him direct and wants to get a question answered on a house, buy a house, whatever, almost every single time he will step out and he will take that call. Now, sometimes it might be as simple as, hey, I see a call. I'm so sorry. I'm with a client right now. Can I call you back in a half hour? Right? But he takes the call if he possibly can. And the reason is he has programmed himself and he programs his agents and he programs his staff. Every one of those calls is worth $10,000. Every one of those calls is a $10,000 commission. You just assume it is. And if you program your mind that way, then you don't, you know, you're driving down the road and you got your McDonald's in the seat beside you and you're eating French fries and the phone rings and it's somebody and you're like, well, I'm eating French fries now. No, that's $10,000 calling. If you program your mind that way, then all of that work you put in on your 19 to connect will not be wasted when you don't contact that lead and they call somebody else, because it does happen. When you call somebody back within the first 5 minutes, right? If you call them back after 5 minutes, statistically, they are 30 times less likely to either take the call or remember who you are in the first place. That 5 minute window is super critically important. All right. Moving on. As you get started in your real estate career and as you begin to generate leads during Ignite, there are some considerations you should make regarding your own lead follow-up plan. You want to match the touch campaigns to your strengths. These are some things to consider. What are my strengths with people? How can I adapt these touches in a way that I can connect to represent who I am? Those are valid questions. So that's how you open phone calls, the content that you have in your messaging, your branding, all of that goes to that. But it really goes to it in how you connect with people, how you talk to them, how you open calls, close calls, how you ask probing questions. All of that is super important. And the scripts are not one size fits all, right? I want you to follow the model. You have to follow the model. You have to do the work. But if you are reading from a script, it sounds like you're reading from a script, okay? I don't normally teach this module in Ignite. So I'm following a script, right? I went over this 10 times in the last 2 days, but I'm still following a script. And you know when I'm reading and when I'm not. There's no question about it. Super easy to tell. So you can modify your call scripts, you can modify your text scripts and your emails and all of that. So it sounds like it's coming from you, so long as you do not alter the intent or the meaning of the content. You don't change it to a point where you're going a different direction with it, because these scripts work. That's why they're there. If something else worked better, that's what would be in the book, right? But you do want it to sound like it comes from you. So make sure that you're working your strengths. What are some reasons I might have for contacting the lead? This is work that you do before the phone call. And I touched on it earlier. If you have a reason to call, then it's not a cold sales call. When you call somebody and say, hey, Bob, just wanted to let you know I was thinking about you and I'd love to sell you a house. Yeah, okay. Well, that's not going to go nearly as well as if you looked at their Facebook page right before you called and saw that little Bobby scored his first soccer goal. Man, is that not awesome? Right? The guy or the lady on the phone is going to be a lot more apt to, because you're talking about them. A simple fact of the matter is people love to talk about themselves. It's human nature. So if you try and gear things to conversations that are about them or about things that are interesting to them, your success ratio will go through the roof. I heard a story some years ago, a guy by the name of Jay Abraham. I don't know if any of you would have ever heard of him or not. He was an old time sales guru back in the day. And he always had these theories of what would work and wouldn't work. And he'd A-B test these theories and all of this. And he was doing a keynote in Sydney, Australia, and he was on the airplane, long flight to Sydney. And he started thinking about what makes people seem interesting. And so he came up with this theory and he wanted to test it. So when he got to the site, just as dumb luck would have it, one of the people who was also staying at the hotel where he was staying, which also was hosting the keynote, was one of the more successful businessmen in Australia. And he recognized him. And so he went to this person's minder and said, hey, I am Jay Abraham. I'm doing a keynote for the blah, blah, blah group tomorrow. And I saw your boss is here. I was wondering if I could just have a word with him. And so he said, sure. And he talked to the guy and he said, yeah, he's at the bar. Just if you'd like, you can go talk to him. So he went and he engaged him in a conversation. And so as a result of his approach, he ended up talking to the guy at the bar, being invited for drinks. They ended up having dinner together and they had after dinner drinks on the roof of the bar that night. And so the next morning, he's in line for breakfast at the buffet and the guy's minder comes up to him and said, I just want you to know, I talked to Mr. blah, blah, blah this morning. And he said, you are one of the most interesting people that he's ever met in his entire life. And you know what he had done? The entire night, not one single time had he ever said a word about himself. He had only talked about the other person. He had asked him questions. He had asked him follow-up questions. He had become interested in what he did and what his life looked like. And not one time did he say a word about himself, not one. And in the eyes of one of the most successful people in the entire country, he was one of the most interesting people that he'd ever met. And the same principle will apply for you in Ignite. It will apply to you in your daily marketing activities. It will apply to you in everything that you do. That simple principle, when you take the time to look at your database and say, oh, well, I'm not just going to put the phone numbers in. I'm going to take the time to look them up on social media and I'm going to fill these little boxes with their Facebook address and their Instagram address and all of that. When it comes time to call them on your four quarterly calls, all you do is click Facebook and you scroll through their thing and you friend them and you scroll through their thing and you look and see find something that is of interest to them, some commonality, something that their family did or a major milestone in their life, or just, you know, they posted a picture of they're super proud of their fettuccine Alfredo they made the other night. Man, I saw that picture. I love fettuccine Alfredo. How'd it turn out? Like, these are things that will endear you to your people who are in your 19 touch campaign. These are the things that will help you get to know them because you're interested in them. You're talking about them. It makes that call super easy. It makes it non-offensive. And at the end of it, hey, do you guys have any plans to buy or sell a property this year? Do you know of anyone who might be buying or selling? Awesome. Thank you so much. That's it. And when it comes time for them to raise their hand, they'll raise their hand. So I know I got off on a tangent, but it works. If you'll work, it'll work. How am I using conversation to let the person know I am in real estate? How to get a hold of me, how to refer to me. Those are important too. And those are all things that you can make readily available to people. None of that's difficult. When is it best for me and my business, the time block to lead follow-up? I'm going to tell you, it's the first 2 hours of the day. If you don't do it in the first 2 hours of the day, you're not going to get it done. You will find an excuse not to do it. Someone will call, something will happen. You'll have a deal blow up. Do it very first thing and get it out of the way. It's just how it works. How much time should I take to reach out to a lead? What happens? What do I do to hold myself accountable? What do I need to do to make sure this happens? So go back to what we talked about in the beginning, which is having an accountability partner. Have someone who will hold you accountable. How many dials are you making a day? How many people are you talking to every day? If you have an accountability, so if you track your results, first of all, tracking your results, if you know how many people you tried to call, how many dials you made, how many people you talked to, and what your results were every single day, then over time, you'll find patterns. And none of that's hard. That's super easy stuff, right? It's not difficult. But if you track it, you'll have patterns and it will tell you, one, some of your scripts are working better than others. Two, you're executing your scripts better than others. Three, you need to work on your overcoming objections. Four, people aren't viewing you as the expert. They're not remembering you. When you call somebody and you want to talk to them about, you know, little Bobby scoring his first goal, and they don't have any idea who you are, then you're not engaging with them on the other touches in the right way. You're not showing up in their Facebook feed or their Instagram feed or these things, because these things all have a cumulative effect and they don't happen overnight, but they will happen if you work them correctly. So it's all about, you'll see these patterns. So make sure absolutely that you are, that you're doing the work and that you're getting, you're keeping track of things and that you have an accountability partner who will make you do the script practice and all of it. And make damn sure that when someone raises their hand and sends you a message or calls you or sends you a text or whatever, you get back to them right now, because that first 5 minutes is everything. Okay. Holy cow. Okay. So now you've had a chance to think about and design your own 19, or you have a chance to design your own 19 touch plans. You'll be able to implement it easier. So we want to make sure that you do this in a way that you don't mess with the first two columns, right? You don't monkey with, you need to make four calls. You need to call once a quarter. You need to do that. I'm going to give you a system for that in a few minutes. You need to make sure that you're getting out your email, newsletter, direct mail, market report, video, whatever. Those have to go out. Make sure you're doing two promotional direct mails and make sure that you're doing one event. If you'll do this, whatever is in the third or in the plan, that's kind of up to you how you put that together. But don't monkey with the numbers. They will work, I promise. Schedule it on your calendar. Do it in advance. You just have to make sure you're doing that. All right. When you have generated a lead and captured their information, you can then talk to them. If you haven't heard back and you don't know much about the person, then your communication will be broader, focusing on a range of values. This is where you'll communicate your value with your own value proposition, which you guys did on day 4 of Ignite. You can even use the company or personal statistics. We know that people are more likely to respond when a message you're communicating feels personal and relative to them. And this goes back to what I just talked about. As you engage with your leads, you can uncover how to serve them better and learn what they're interested in. As you learn this, you can segment your leads into specific groups. And I know you've already talked to that, but hopefully that makes a little more sense to you. Relevant conversations have more value, are timely, and lead to greater opportunity for a future conversation. So talking to your relatives about real estate is going to be a different experience than talking to someone who is a sphere of influence person on your list, meaning someone who you already knew, who is a friend, a neighbor, a relative, a former coworker, somebody that you know from your kid's school, someone that you already have a connection with. Those conversations are going to be different with someone who you got from a Zillow call, or someone who called in to the office and you had to be assigned you, or someone that you met during an open house. Right? Those are all different. So if you segment those, then you'll find that you'll be better off. This is where doing the extra work will pay huge dividends. Friend the people on social media, find out what it is that they're interested in. Get their social media addresses in your database. The more complete your database is, the better you're going to execute on your calls and everything else. It will make a huge difference. Okay, the communicate with value page, that's page 22 in your book. Once you know the source of lead, you can narrow your range of value. Knowing the source of lead helps you inform you on how you compare a value with your communication. For example, a lead generated through a client referral will be communicated differently from a lead that came in from a phone call. How many leads did you start with? Let's start with that. Because the most valuable leads that you have are your sphere. Because one, done correctly, they will buy or sell with you. And two, they're the highest likely leads in your contacts in your database to provide you with referrals, which is something that you desperately want. So how many of those do you have? We tell our team, when you come to work on day one, 250 leads, and we want them in your database. And then we want you pruning those leads. We want you working through those leads. We want to make sure that you're absolutely doing a good job with those leads and that you're making them complete and you're putting in the social media stuff and you're trying to get their address. In Command, you can see a lead score, you know, how, like the status of your health score of your leads. And you want to continually be upping that number because that means you have more and more value in your database, that your database is going to be worth more the higher that number is. So make sure that you're doing all of that. All right, I'm going to skip through ahas. Post lead follow up. Real quick, let's go to, this is your post lead follow-up. When a lead becomes a contact in your database, when you have that high value contact, then you're moving them into a different level. You're going to cultivate those for conversion. So now you go from trying to move that lead from a lead to a contact to conversion. That's the next goal, is to convert them into something meaningful that's going to generate business for you. And you can do that through a 36 touch plan. And everything that I've just talked about is exactly the same other than the steps of your campaign. And so you need to go back and figure out what your 36 touch campaign is going to look like. All of that was on a previous slide. It's all in your book, so you can get to it and use it, no problem. And you want to make sure you're connecting. Everyone who you put into your database as a sphere, as someone that you know, as someone that you're close to, those are people who should be in a 36 touch campaign, because you know those people. You can call and talk to them anyway, right? They're the highest likelihood of conversion for you, so they need to be in a 36 touch campaign. Next, we're going to talk about one to cement real quick, because I want to make sure I got one thing I want to cover. At the point where a lead opens the door for a two-way conversation, you must cement the relationship. There's a lot of ways to do that. What I'm going to tell you is during that interaction, whatever that interaction looks like, make sure that you tell them about the services that you provide, that you sell properties, you specialize in Hilliard, Ohio, and such subdivision, and that You are able to also show them properties anywhere in Columbus. Make sure you set up a conversation for later. Hey, Bob, is it okay if I give you a call in about 2 weeks and just touch base with you and see where you guys are at in your process, whatever. Create that next step. Serve as a reminder of the interaction. Tell them how to refer business to you. Listen, Bob, the easiest way to get a hold of me, if you want to refer somebody to me, if you know anybody, is to just shoot me a text, let me know who it is, or I'll give you a call, get the information, whatever works best for you. But the best way to contact me is to just shoot me a quick text and then I'll get right back with you. That way you don't have to not answer the phone and you can still get back with them within the 5 minutes. What if you offered them something as a result of that contact? What if you found out that they were interested, as a result of that conversation, you found out that they were interested in model airplanes, and you take 5 minutes and you scroll the internet and you find a really cool article on model airplanes, and you send them an email or you send them a text with an attachment and say, hey, Bob, I know you like model airplanes. I just saw this and thought I'd send it to you. Hopefully you haven't seen it yet and you get something out of it. Have a great day, right? And you're cementing that relationship by giving them something of value. It's as wide as you want it to be. You can absolutely come up with a million things to do that. And it's like, that is something that will pay huge dividends. So, all right. Let's move on to real quick success systems. Every day you need to have a success system. Every day. And it should be about 2 hours. 20 minutes of it should be role play. It should be script practice. It should be something that makes you better at your craft of communicating with your clients. Every day you need to do that. Top agents do this every day. I'm talking people that do 30, 40, 50, $100 million in sales. They do this every day. Why? Because it works. Because it's a fundamental of the business and you can't skip the fundamentals. You've got to do them right. 10 minutes, prepare your call list for the day. If you're using a CRM like Command, that's really easy to do. And I'm gonna give you a system for that in just a second. 45 minutes, real play, real life play, that is making the phone calls, it's doing the work. 30 minutes is updating your database, that's how much you're gonna spend on that. That's putting information back in your database based on your calls, your contacts with customers, notes. If you put a note in there that you talked to Bob today and found out that he is definitely interested in selling in 3 weeks, you can put that information in as a note. You can also set a reminder for you to call him back. All of that matters. So make sure that you are 100% using your success system. Your daily success tracker system includes 10 conversations with your sphere, with your people in your sphere. You must do that. You must add 10 new contacts to your database, 10 handwritten notes, and the 10-5-1 model for social media engagement. That is 10 comments on people's posts. If you comment on 10 posts a day, and then you send 5 people messages and you do 1 post a day, that is the gold standard for winning the game in social media. And if you'll do that every day, over and over and over again, and I'm talking Saturdays and Sundays included, it will pay huge dividends for you. So make sure that you are doing that. So the first job of a real estate agent is lead gen. But lead gen means calling and talking to people. So I've got to give you the obligatory speech on making sure that you are not violating any guidelines, because it's crazy expensive if you do, and you don't, and it's a hassle and you don't want to do it, and it requires attorneys and it's a bad deal. So you want to make sure that you're scrubbing your list through the do not call list. So I have to say this verbatim. Today, you're going to make calls of your sphere and people in your database. Before you make any calls or texts, please remember to honor the TCPA and do not call lists, including those of your market center and state. If you have any questions or concerns about this, please consult your market center or attorney to ensure compliance. Refer to the pages at the beginning of your participation guide for more details. These guidelines are for your protection as well as for the protection of your clients. Let's review the importance of the Telephone Consumer Protection Act and do not call list restrictions for when you make calls or text to your database. Turn to those pages and go over them. It's your responsibility to subscribe to the call registry. Check before you call. Update your call list regularly. You can download your database and you can scrub it through the do not call list. It's not a difficult thing. Someone in your market center can help you with that. Honor your consumer's requests. If they tell you they don't want to talk to you, don't try and talk to them, because go find somebody who does want to talk to you. That's the game. And know the state and federal laws. Those are your responsibility and those are up to you. Before you start your process of making phone calls, I'm going to tell you a quick one that works for us. It works for a lot of people and it puts your head in the right space. And that is, define what you're grateful for and why before you start making your phone calls. Our team will very often write down a personal thing that they're grateful for and a professional thing that they're grateful for. And the reason is, it is impossible to feel depressed, to feel upset, to feel mad, to feel negative emotions when you feel grateful. The two don't work together. So if you can put yourself in a place of feeling grateful, your results will come through for you on the phone. People will hear that in your voice. They can tell if you're depressed from your voice. They can tell if you're upset. So make sure that you're putting yourself in the right headspace. You can also begin by, a lot of people use affirmations to get themselves ready to make calls. The one that they suggest here is, I engage every conversation in the spirit of contribution and people are happy to be in a relationship with me. And you say it out loud and you let yourself hear the words over and over again. Do it 5 times before you start making calls. It will matter. Make sure you're doing your role plays every day. Make sure you're doing your script practice every day. And then this is the one thing that I really wanted to make sure that I got into with you. And I'm going to stop my screen share for just a second because I want to change it. If you have not heard of this, I want you to make sure that you look it up. And it is the DTD2 program. So systematizing how you call people is critically important. Someone, and I can't tell you who it was, I don't know if it was a Keller Williams person or whether it was somebody else, but it's brilliant, came up with a process or a program where they automate how they call their database. And every quarter, they do it this way. Anybody who starts with A or their last name starts with A or W, they call them week one. Anybody who is last name starts with an N, they text them in week one. And then week two and week three and week four, through all 13 weeks of the quarter. And what that does is it stops something called confirmation bias. When we look at a lead, we have a tendency to find things about that person that will confirm our preconceived incorrect notions very often. So when you're doing it this way, you're systematizing your call approach, and you can simply look up DTD2 on the internet, and there's a million examples of it out there that will work for you. And I implore you to use this system. Now, what this requires is that you put a tag in each contact in your database. Like we use ANW, BNE, DNO, all of that. That's a tag so that when we're searching our database, when we want to try and scrub our database for who we're going to call today, Week one, we call the A's and the W's, and we work our way through it. And we try and get every single one of them called that week. And the reason why they came up with those combinations of letters is because when you look at how many people's names start with those, it is a fairly close proximity of having the same number of people statistically each week to call. So that's why they do that. So please use that approach and use this program. We implemented it and it works like an absolute dream. So we definitely want you doing that. All right. There's a lot of ways that you can get help, and I'm gonna give you one of them. If you need help with the anything in command, if you're putting your contacts in a phone book, in a handwritten phone book, or any other thing, you're wasting your time. Put them in command. Use command, please. There is a series of videos online. It is Marty Miller's 66 Days of Command. He's done many versions of it, and it will take you through 66 lessons on how to use command. You can also go into the part of command that is, I'm trying to think of the web address. It's easy to find. agent.kw.command. I'm not sure if that's it or not, but use your resources. Someone in your market center can help you. Someone in your market center can make it easy for you. Make sure that you do that. That's all I've got for today, guys. I really, really appreciate you jumping on here and taking the time. Hopefully we've been able to provide some things of value for you. Kelly will be on at 2 o'clock or 1 o'clock from 1 to 3, and she's going to be taking the next segment. And you guys, I promise you will absolutely enjoy it. And you'll learn a lot from her. She is absolutely one of the best that there are. Is there any questions that I can answer for anyone on what we've covered today? I'm more than happy to talk for as long as anybody wants, and I'll answer any questions. Just unmute and ask. All right, good deal. All right, I appreciate your time. Hopefully you learned something. Have a great day.